homesteads and homeschools as part of the Liberty Hippie Podcast Network. If you like what we do, be sure to check out This Week in Liberpods, Peace Freaks, Cannabis Heals Me, and Free Markets Green Earth. We're living proof that libertarian doesn't mean washed up Republican.
What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Homesteads and Homeschools. I am your host, the Liberty Hippie, here with you for another episode, episode number 94, which means you can find the show notes for today's show at homesteadsandhomeschools.com/094. And you will want to check out the show notes today because there are going to be a handful of links in all sorts of places. You can find my guest and check him out because you know you want to, and you might just need to. So keep that in mind. What else to do? I'm going to tell you up front this time. Go over to homesteadsandhomeschools.com/Amazon, click through the affiliate link, buy your junk, and I get a kickback. And that is awesome. What else can you do? You can go leave a review on iTunes, because that's always fun. Write something stupid in there, give it 5 stars, and be done. You know, something comical. Tell me to get a haircut. Something. I don't know. Anything. What else can I tell you to do? I guess that's it. My guest today, I'll quit rambling. My guest today is a guy. I've heard him before on a couple of different shows, notably Lions of Liberty there with Mark Clary. Did a round table with him, and decided to have him on and kind of talk about some of the things that he does and what it is that he does. He's lived overseas for quite some time. He's down in Panama now. But talk about how he works with school, right? How school worked for him and what he's doing with his daughter and his future plans. And I think you guys will enjoy it. I think he has a lot to say that we didn't necessarily get to, but who knows, maybe you go listen to his podcast, you'll get some of those answers that I didn't get to ask. But I guess that's it for now. Let's go plant those liberty seeds with my guest, Mr. Mikkel Thorup.
I took off for a weekend last month just to try and recall the whole year, all of the faces and all of the places, wondering where they all disappeared.
My guest today is Mr. Mikkel Thorup down there in Panama. He's here today. We're going to talk about school stuff. So, Mikkel, thank you for your time. I know you are a busy guy doing all sorts of things, so we appreciate it.
My pleasure, Ben. This is going to be fun today. I mean, I get interviewed literally like every day, every second day, but I don't get interviewed enough on the education things because I'm really, really passionate about this stuff, and I enjoy talking about it. So hopefully today, maybe I can inspire your guests a little bit, maybe share some of my experiences, and I'm looking forward to today's conversation.
It is one of those things where you can have your ideas on education, and it's just kind of there on the side. And if it's not your main thing, it never doesn't really come up, but it can be something that you're very passionate about. So curious, because you're overseas now. What was your education like growing up? Were you homeschooled? Were you public schooled, private school? What did that look like for you?
So I went through public school, and what happened was I'm Canadian. I was born in southwestern Ontario. And I remember I was in grade three, and the teachers and the resource teachers and the principal, they pulled me out of class. And apparently I had been diagnosed with quote unquote a learning disability. So these teachers and principals, they pulled me outside of class in the middle of the day and brought me to a little room and sat me down, and they said, Mikkel, things don't work quite right in your brain. And what we want to do is we want to send you to a special school, special school for special boys. And Ben, that's what they did. Every day for 3 years, I got on a little white bus and I took the little white bus across town and I went to this special school, quote unquote. Now, the real problem was it wasn't actually a special school. It was a regular school with a special class. So I'm sure you can guess, kids are mean. Like, as soon as you're a little bit different, something works something a little bit differently. There's teasing and bullying and you get picked on and I was in fights and I had my nose broken and I was in the hospital, like all these horrible things. Now, don't get me wrong, this is not a woe is me story by any means. Like, I gave as good as I got. There's no question about that, you know? Like, I'm a libertarian, so like, you know, I'm not going to start a fight, but I'll certainly give back. So I went to this special school for 3 years, but I hated it. It was a horrendous experience. Literally every day I would come home from school crying and I didn't want to go back. I just absolutely hated it. But grade 7 comes up and I'm finally allowed to return to my neighborhood school. And I'm going to see all my friends from before and see all the people that I used to know. And I was so excited. I thought they would be so excited to see me. But once again, I guess I'm going to assume you can guess what happens. I go back and everybody starts like gossiping and whispering. Oh, what happened to him? I know him. Mm-hmm. He went to some retard school, you know, 1980s, totally politically correct, very sensitive, very calm, you know, like gentle children. He went to some retard school. Excellent. Thanks, guys. So once again, what happens? I get into more fights. I get picked on. I get bullied, you know, and I just didn't like it. I just decided one day, I'm like, I don't like this. This is not how it's supposed to be. So I stopped going. And then I started failing. And then they'd send me to summer school. And then I'd start failing that. And I'd stop going to that. And then I got into high school. And it didn't get any better there. So I stopped going to that. And so basically at 12 years old, I stopped going to school. And at 15, I had officially dropped out. And I started traveling internationally, you know, a couple of years later. And here I am. I'm overseas. I'm a teenager all by myself. And I'm meeting these unbelievable people who are so well educated and they've done so many amazing things, but they've done it all in like a very different way. And that's what I really started to learn, is that there's not only one way to learn things. Like, you don't have to go through this rigid set manner of education. Actually, traveling and being exposed to people in different countries and different cultures, that is its own form of education. You learn something from that. So basically, fast forward, I've dedicated my entire life to this. I've spent more than 20 years on the road now. I've visited more than 100 countries. I've lived in 8 different countries, and I've circumnavigated the planet more than 400 times. Now, anybody today who meets me, I would never think that they would call me uneducated. Yes, I left school at a very young age. You know, I certainly didn't go to college. I dropped out of high school, but that doesn't mean that I'm not educated. You know, I'm a voracious reader. I've worked with mentors, with coaching, with mastermind. I read over 100 books a year and have done for 20 plus years, because that desire and that seed of exploring and curiosity, it was never like beaten out of me as a child. And I think that's actually my advantage. I think that's like my superpower. And if anything, I'm very proud of myself for at 12, 13, 14 years old, just like saying, this is not right, this is wrong, and removing myself from the situation peacefully.
That's quite a story there. When you first got like placed there in that other school, did your parents have much say in that? Or was it kind of like the school just said, okay, this is where you're going? Your parents, because I'm trying to think, you know, like, I don't know, at that point, like, do you know that you can advocate for your child? Like, could they, like, how did that go?
Well, I think that there was so much faith, and especially in Canada, with the government and with the teachers and with authority figures, that when they said, this is what's best for Mikkel, you know, they just listened. I don't think my parents ever meant to do anything bad or wrong. Like, my parents love me. My parents are amazing. There's no question about that. However, I mean, we didn't have the resources to go out there and look and understand these things. This is late 80s, early 90s. So it's like, I don't even know. Yeah. I don't even know if the internet existed at that point. It certainly, if it did, it certainly was not in a household that people would have access. And even if that was the case, the generation from my parents are still, they're not used to just going and looking things up or finding awesome programs like yours. Like things like this just didn't exist. So they're like, okay, send your kid to here. He has a learning disability. It'll be better for him. Actually, it was worse.
Yeah, I can only imagine. And I think that was kind of what I expected. You know, is it just at that point, even today, so many people just take it as, you know, that's what they say. The school told me to do this, so I have to do that. So they're thinking about the best interest of my child when, you know, it's definitely not always the case. You know, it's what's better for them and their system. And that doesn't always work out in the best interest of the child. But when you dropped out of school, how was that? Did you have to fill out any paperwork? Was that just kind of you just left on your own accord? How did that go?
Well, Ben, I was a willful child. Like, I'm a willful adult. Like, try to force a 14-year-old or 15-year-old to do anything. I mean, and then try to force me to do something and see how that works. Like, my parents were separated at the time. So my father worked, you know, my mother lived in another place and she was still part of my life, absolutely. But I mean, there was no one there to watch me in the mornings. So I had every trick under the book for getting out of class. You know, they would call and leave a message on the voice machine. Well, I'd go and delete that. I'd pack up my stuff and I'd pretend to go. And then when my father drove away, I would come right back to the house. Or I would show up to school and I would be there for attendance. I'd ask to use the washroom and then I wouldn't come back to class. Or I mean, like every little sneaky thing you could think of to get out of this situation, that was me. I just hated it. Like, it was just such an uncomfortable, horrendous experience. I didn't understand it at all. I didn't understand why I was being forced to do these things, why I was being taught this stuff. It didn't interest me. I wanted nothing to do with that. I didn't like the other kids. Like, it was just all around was not a healthy environment. It was not conducive to my learning at all.
And I think that's impressive that you can kind of catch that, right? That this is this environment, this thing that I'm in right now is not helping me. It's not helping my education, and it's not not there. Did you enjoy learning at that point in time? Like, maybe not in that school setting, but kind of on your own, whether it was, I don't know, some hobby that you would pick up and dig into, or were you just kind of...
Yeah, like, I think that always in my life, I've had certain things that I'm into, and I can be a very obsessive compulsive type of person where when I go into something, I go fully in. Like, at that age, I was into martial arts, and I ended up being on Team Canada for martial arts, and I used to travel internationally as a teenager and compete. Well, you know, that was my passion. That's what I wanted to do, and that's what I would study for 6 hours or 8 hours a day, and, you know, I would be really into those things. For the majority of my life, I was very much into fitness and health and things like that. I love that type of stuff, and when I found traveling, I mean, I just got so obsessed with it, and the history and languages and culture and food and community and the people. I mean, these types of things are so fascinating for me. If I go for a walk, I'm the one who always wants to like turn the corner. I want to see what's around the corner. Okay, just a little bit further. You know, I just want to see a little bit more. I just love it. You know, like just seeing something new and experiencing something new.
Where did you end up going when you went overseas? What was the plan? Was the plan to just kind of wander around someplace? Were you planning on coming back and maybe trying to find, I don't know, some sort of college program or something like that? Or did you have an idea of what you wanted to do with yourself at that point when you started going over?
So it's interesting. My father had traveled a lot when he was like in his 20s. He had gone backpacking through Europe. And he had always told me growing up, this was the greatest thing I ever did with my life. And I was like, wow, if it was the greatest thing you ever did with your life, like, why did you only go like once or twice? Like, why didn't you dedicate more of your time? So when I was a teenager, I went to one of these martial arts competitions. We went to Ireland, England, and Wales to compete. And my father was with me. And that's when I really saw like how amazing this was and kind of understood what he had been talking about all these times. So after that, I came back and just started working. Well, actually, I had already been working, just at neighborhood jobs like grocery stores and stocking shelves and just normal things that, you know, teach you a bit of responsibility as a teenager, and started saving my money. And then when I was about 18 or maybe 18, I went back to Europe, but this time by myself. So I went through all of Western Europe, like England, France, Belgium, Holland, Spain, Portugal, and then ran out of money. So I was like, well, I don't want to go home yet, but like I'm getting really low on funds. So I took a ferry over from Spain to Morocco, and then I spent 2 months backpacking around Morocco. And I went to the Sahara Desert. I got on a camel and went to Algeria, the border, right? The border with Algeria, 3 days on a camel, and then came back. I spent 2 months there, which was literally like the length of my visa. And seeing people do things in a completely different manner than, you know, than we would ever do it back in Canada. First of all, it's a Muslim country. Add to that, I mean, there's Portuguese and Spanish influence. They're Muslim, but they have Arabic influence, and then they have the Berbers. So then you'll have these dark-skinned people with crystal clear blue eyes, and they speak French, and they eat like baguettes every day. Like, it's such a mishmash of different things. They have their own cuisine. And I was like, this is unbelievable. I love this. So when I got back to Canada, I went back to my old job, and I think I lasted like 2 weeks. And I was like, I can't do this. I hate this. So I had a sister that lived in Calgary. So I took a one-way flight out there and then moved out to the ski resorts. I stayed with her for a few days, moved to the ski resorts, then spent 18 months basically skiing all winter and mountain biking all summer and just working, saved up cash, and then went down to Latin America and spent 18 months hitchhiking and backpacking through Latin America. So that was Mexico, Belize, well, all southern United States, Mexico, Belize, Guatemala. I was in Guatemala for 5 months, El Salvador, Costa Rica, Nicaragua, Panama, and then took a yacht for 7 days and went to Colombia, spent 2 months in Colombia, and then came back. And that was just backpacking. Yeah. And then I was in New Zealand for a year and I worked there. Then I was 3 years in Australia, in Melbourne. I traveled out all through those countries, went all over the South Pacific, lived in Singapore for a year. Then just for shits and giggles, I moved to the Arctic. I was 366 days in the Arctic, which was a very, very interesting experience. And then I moved to the Middle East, and I was 8 years in the Middle East, and last year I moved my family to Panama. That's like 20 years kind of condensed into about 3 minutes, but I mean...
Hey, it's impressive. I haven't traveled too much. I spent a little bit of time over in Korea teaching, and so, you know, I can't comment the same that you can, but I will say that being immersed in someone else's culture, like living in someone else's culture, is just kind of mind-blowing. You just like you start to realize things and see things that you wouldn't pick up from a book or from something on the television that you watched or whatever. So it's really kind of an interesting way of educating yourself, I think. I don't know. And I'm sure you would recommend travel to people if that was their,
oh, absolutely, their thing. Well, my favorite thing to do is to go sit on a park bench or in a cafe or in a restaurant or something like that, and just like people watch, and just watch absolutely normal people do 100% normal things completely different than I would back home. I mean, that is so fascinating because there's so many preconceptions that people have about different cultures or different races or religions or any of these things. They think like we're good and right and they're bad and wrong. Well, I hate to be the one to break it to you, but it's not true. Like all over the world is good people. People are all the same. And literally, I don't care if you are tall, short, fat, skinny, gay, straight, black, white, LGBT, straight. I don't, it doesn't matter to me. People want the same thing. They want a roof over their head. They want a full belly. They want to protect their family. They want to be loved. They want to build something. I mean, people are people are people. I've traveled extensively in Uganda, in Nigeria, in Botswana, all through Africa. They want the same thing. I've been to Iran, to North Korea. I spent 2 weeks in North Korea. Trust me, the people want the exact same thing. You know, these countries that are supposed to be the axis of evil. No, the government is messed up. Government is messed up everywhere in the world. But the people are good, like inherently good. Does that make sense?
Yeah, for sure. And I think that's something that we kind of miss out on when you don't really explore. These other ideas that are, you know, that, like you said, the axis of evil, right? It's not necessarily the people. It might be a few people, but for the most part, it's the government and those policies that are enacted and put into place. And it's, you know, look at the U.S. all over the Middle East and stuff. That's not necessarily like the people. It's not me and other people. You know, it's what government policy is. But I don't know. So you are in Panama. You said you've been there for 8 years now. So you said
no. So I was 8 years in the Middle East.
Okay.
And then about a year and a half, almost 2 years here in Panama. We made the move last June. Yeah, so about 18 months, I'd say.
So you and I know you said you had a daughter. So she was born over there in the Middle East. When you moved with her, what kind of prompted that move or why Panama, I guess?
So Panama is a couple of reasons. I'm big into finance, and you know, my work with escape artists and with my podcast, The Expat Money Show, is all about protecting from the downside. We work a lot in defense. We work with the legal structures and with the accounting and with the investments, but we're always looking to hedge our bets and protect ourselves. And just looking at what was happening in the world, I could see that we were in store for a really big crash. It's just all signs were pointing in this direction. And I took a look around, and although I lived in Abu Dhabi, although I loved Abu Dhabi and I thought it was just an amazing, beautiful place, I understood that if there was some type of massive crisis, that was not a great place to be. So first of all, like at that time, the U.S. was really gearing up for war with Iran. And like I said before, I've been to this country, I've met the people, and it's so beautiful there. And I knew that they would use the UAE as a staging ground for invading Iran. And I didn't want to be anywhere near anything like that. I didn't want to be part of anything like that. So we looked at that, and then we thought, okay, in the UAE, it's literally desert. So there's no fresh water. If there's any type of problems, all the water that we have is from desalination. So if they attack the oil refineries or anything like that, they're not going to be able to produce energy. They're not going to be able to produce fresh drinking water. So I didn't like that. Then they don't grow any of their food. Everything is brought in. Everything is imported. They grow a tiny bit, but like next to nothing. Certainly enough, not enough to feed the population. And the other thing is, and I don't know in Fahrenheit, but in Celsius, it's about 55 degrees Celsius in the summer, which means you must run your air conditioning. Like mandatory. Like you will die. Mm-hmm. You'll cook. Like it's like an oven. So I looked at these things and I was like, ooh, I don't like any of this. So we started searching around, and I work a lot in visas and things like that. And I knew Panama has this amazing program called the Friendly Nations Visa, where for basically $5,000, you can move an entire family here and be legal to work in the country. It's an economic visa, so you have to show some source of income. I have an online business, so that's no problem. It's a tax-free country, which fits perfectly in line with my libertarian values. They have no standing military here, which also, you know, I'm very anti-war. And tons of fresh drinking water, tons of fresh vegetables. Like it's like volcanic soil. I mean, you can grow anything here. You can just throw a seed out your window and tomorrow it'll be a tree. Like it's unbelievable.
Nice.
And it's just a nice, peaceful, safe, interesting, beautiful country. And I had studied Spanish 20 years previous when I was hitchhiking and backpacking through the region. I'd already been over here once, so I was like, I wanted to get my language. I wanted to bring it up to a higher level. So we looked at all of these types of things and thought, you know, this should be interesting.
Did you consider the school system there at all? How does that work? Do you know if they have a public school, or do you have to put your kid in private school if you want to go to
So they have public schools here. I don't know anyone who uses them personally. Everybody that I know uses the international schools or homeschooling. And okay. I mean, like, I wouldn't really necessarily call myself a homeschooler in that we don't follow a curriculum. I think the best to describe what we do is world schooling. So I don't know if you've had guests talk about this on your show, but basically, we travel with our daughter and we expose her to different cultures and different groups of people. And we do really interest-based learning. Now, and just to put things in context, my wife is from mainland China. So we met on a flight to Germany. I met her in Germany. Then we got married in Africa. And my daughter was born in the Middle East, and we're now live in Panama. She's mainland from mainland China. I'm Canadian with Danish heritage. So my daughter's 4 years old. She's already been to 12 countries. She's already plays with kids from all over the world. She speaks two languages, like Chinese and English are both fluent. They're both first languages, mother tongues. And now we're working on Spanish with her. So, I mean, we take her to the park every day. We take her to the pool every day. And she spends time with other kids, all in Spanish. Her best friend is from Russia. So she does a lot in that. She loves these Ukrainian and Russian cartoons. So she watches a lot of like those types of cartoons, all in Russian, or, well, usually even the Ukrainian ones are in Russian as well. So she has exposure to that language. My wife does spend, you know, 1 to 2 hours with her every morning, and they go through flashcards and spaced repetition for understanding the Chinese characters, because you really do have to work through those things. You can't just assimilate that with like a lot of other things. You can just kind of assimilate. With this, you have to work through. So we do spaced repetition with her. We play games and things like that. And my prerogative is, as long as we teach her how to read, write, and spell, and basic arithmetic, then, I mean, everything else will take care of itself. Like, I think, like, if she's into dance, then we'll take her to dance classes, and she can do that. And if tomorrow she wants to learn about history, we'll plan around that. Like, but it's all based off of her. You know, and my dream is always that, like, if we are going to teach history, you know, maybe we can make like a little project, and we'll be like, okay, let's learn about Italy. So let's learn about the Roman Empire. Then let's use that as a way to teach economics and money. Okay, well, if we're talking about money, then let's use that a way to learn about math and subtraction and multiplication, how to actually use math in real life circumstances. Not trigonometry, which she's never going to use in her life unless she decides she wants to be an engineer or, you know, an architect or something like that. And then, you know, take it a step further, like, okay, if she's into this stuff, if she enjoys it, why don't we start cooking Italian food in the house? Why don't we like do the history of why did they use these types of ingredients? Where did they come from? Okay, why is it called this? Let's learn the language and all of that type of history. And then, you know, daddy's got to speak on stage over there. You know, why don't we spend an extra month in Italy and go over and make some friends and hang out. We'll stay in an Airbnb for a month or 2 months. Like for me, like that's like a cool educational experience. Not just one person standing at the front of the room and talking at you for 8 hours in a day, you know?
Like, yeah, for sure. For sure. And I think that's key. If you like, we don't quite do like the unschooling thing. We kind of use more of a curriculum, trying to get away from it. But, I think that's it. If you can give them the tools, right? The basic tools, like, you know how to do some, your basic math, you know how to read and you can write and, you know, they can, you can take that and go miles with it. You know, you can explore anything you want as long as you have that. And I think that's one of the things that, you know, a program that's outside of the public realm, kind of gives you. And you guys sounds like are just diving right into that. That's be fascinating. Does she play with, I know you said she plays with like friends or whatever. Are there any like, older kids or like, co-op type things? Have you seen any kids doing that sort of thing in that sort of,
Yes. So I mentioned earlier her best friend just turned 8 and my daughter is 4 and they're like, Two peas in a pod. I mean, they're inseparable and we see them every single week and I'm friends with the parents. So, you know, we'll sit down and have a glass of wine and the kids will play. And it's amazing because my daughter looks at someone who's older than them and sees how they behave and interacts. So she gets something out of the relationship and the other girl gets to practice responsibility because we always tell her, I'm like, okay, you have to take care of her. You have to make sure she doesn't do, you know, get herself into trouble. Like, so if we're going for a walk, she'll make sure she holds her hand and crosses the street. We'd go to the beach with them. We've gone out to the islands with them and stuff. She looks after her. So, I mean, that's an educational experience for the other girl where she's already at the forefront where she knows she's the responsible one. Now, put that in reverse. With traditional education, you get 30, 32 kids, all exactly the same age, and none of them have any idea how to behave. None of them know what they're supposed to do. So they can't teach anything and they can't learn anything. Really, all they learn is like bad habits from other kids. So I don't understand why we've always decided that we need to segregate children based on age, because I've never seen in any other example in life where you do this. I have lots of friends who are 20, 30, 40 years older than me. Actually, like on my podcast, my favorite thing is to interview guys who are in like their 70s and 80s and who have so much world experience and life experience. And then I'm like, I get to ask them all these questions. And what do you think about this? And what's your insight on that? I mean, that's really fascinating for me. I would never have my podcast. I am only allowed to have 37-year-olds on my podcast. That's it. And next year, 38s. That's it. No, no. Can't change it. Like, it makes no sense to me at all.
I think the only sense it makes is that it's easier to standardize it, right? It's easier to just teach this year, this next year. And that way, everybody will have this, quote, comprehensive education, and you'll pick everything up. And that's, like you said, that's not the way life is, you know? And that's not how you learn things, you know? And I think being able to interact with children that are different age than you, that bring something else to the table, you know, it teaches you that skill as an adult, too, to, you know, that... Okay, they're a bunch older than me. Maybe they're, you know, they're younger than me. He's 10 years younger than me, but he still has something to say that like I can learn from, that is there, that, you know, I feel like you develop those relationships better. And you're able to kind of glean more from life itself if you're, you know, more in tuned to that sort of thing. But I don't know. We've seen that to some degree with our kids too, because, you know, go to a homeschool co-op once in a while. And, you know, it is, you have young kids, you have older kids, you have kids that are on the spectrum that they would otherwise not interact with because they'd be locked away in some classroom in the school that, you know, and all those things that you get to learn. And just, I don't know, I feel like it makes your life better, more rounded.
Absolutely. And as to your point about segregation, yeah, it works a certain percentage of the time, but then you get a kid like me, and it didn't work. And you try to force me through that. Like, you know, well, I mean, it does make it easier for them to just to classify and group everybody. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, well, these are all the grade fives. These are all the grade sixes. These are the grade sevens. I mean, to standardize things. But it doesn't work in the way that it's going to help the child or benefit the child in any respect. And I mean, what is the point of all of this? For me, the point is to, you know, give my daughter the tools to be able to go out there and function, to be happy, to have strong relationships, to communicate, to have fun, to enjoy herself. I mean, but does traditional school do any of those types of things? I would argue no. Like that's certainly not the most efficient way to do it.
There's probably, you know, your outliers that it might, but at the same time, that for the vast majority, I don't know. I don't think it works for them. So I'm kind of curious, when your daughter is like 16, 17, and she wants to go out and traipse across the world just like you did. have you thought about that conversation yet?
No, I try not to think too far forwards. I mean, my hope is that I will always be able to teach my daughter enough personal responsibility that I'll be okay with these types of things. You know,
yeah.
Like, there's not much else I can say about it. Like, I want to teach her things now. We talk to her like an adult, even when she's 4 years old. The answer I got as a child was, because I said so. Why is this? Because I said so. No, that doesn't do anything for me. Like, my daughter had this, here's a funny example. She thought it was funny, I guess, to throw things out the window. Now, I have a penthouse apartment in downtown Panama. I have all of the 15th and all of the 16th floor. And these big floor-to-ceiling windows. And all of a sudden, toys started to go missing. So we would ask her, and she'd be like, nope, didn't do it. I didn't throw anything. No, we actually caught her doing it. Like, just literally just getting angry and just chucking stuff out the window. And we're like, you can't do that. She's like, why? So I sit her down. Well, baby, you know, if this came down and it fell and it hit someone in the head, it would really hurt. How would you feel if this came and landed on your head? Would you cry? Would that hurt? Do you want to do that to someone else? Do you want to make someone else cry? You have to think about other human beings and how they might feel. It's dangerous. We try to explain all of the repercussions about what her actions are going to do. Do you know what she says afterwards? Oh, okay. I get it.
Yeah.
It's not just because I said so, because it's the rule, because that's not what you do, because it's against the law, because that's what the teacher said. No, we sit down, we explain it to her like an adult. And you know what? She hasn't done it since. Like, I mean, like a good conversation, and it's okay now.
Yeah, and I think that teaches that skill of like thinking things through as well, you know, and not just because someone said so, not appealing to authority and like, this is why you have to do it or not do it. Like you actually think, and what's the reason? What's the rationale? Okay. That makes sense. You know,
empathy, trying to put yourself in other people's situation. How are they going to feel? What are they going through? I mean, this is really important things. This, what do they call it? EQ, how people react to things. How do they feel? I mean, I don't remember that being taught in school. Do you? Like,
and as you know, there's not a whole lot of empathy out there on the playground either.
Mm-hmm. So
that's all right. Well, I appreciate it. I know you've anything else you want to say about your schooling program or anything we missed that you wanted to?
Oh, I mean,
touch on?
I could talk literally all day. I'm pretty I'm pretty outgoing and pretty passionate about all of these things. You know, I have a lot of people who are very set in the traditional education and think what I'm doing is some type of a crime by educating my child myself. I don't understand this. I think it's like completely bogus because even look at history. Mm-hmm. Human beings have been on the planet for what, 50,000 years or something like that? And we've had formal education for like what, 120 years, 150 years? So like you think that Da Vinci, he wasn't educated because he didn't go through? Like,
yeah.
Aristotle, like, I mean, like look at in history how people were taught. They were taught through apprenticeships. They were taught through mentoring. They were taught through discovery and experimentation. They were not taught just one person talking at them at the front of the room. So, I mean, that's kind of like things that I'm a big history buff. So I like to look at those types of things. And that's why I say we don't really have like a set model because I've taken little pieces from many different things, doing what I feel is the best. And then you know what? If I'm wrong, we'll modify it. Like I'm not rigid at this at all.
That's the glory of it all. You have that flexibility to change things. Even if it's something that's right, but it's not working for your child or with your child, you can change it and add no problems.
There's no hard and fast rules with any of these types of things. You know, there are core tenets that I want her to teach. I want to teach her. Personal responsibility being number one is so, so important. Empathy, which we just talked about. Language and communications is extremely important. When you look at all of technology and what is happening in the world with robotics and artificial intelligence and blockchain and automation and all of these different things, Internet of Things. The one thing that I absolutely know that will still be applicable in the future is communication, being able to interact effectively with other human beings. Why am I going to try to teach my child today for a workforce which is not going to exist in 20 years, which is what traditional education is doing? They're teaching you for the past. They're not teaching you for what's happening right now or what will be happening in 20 years. So if you focus on those core things that will never change, I would argue that the things that I've just listed in 500 years will still be important things to humanity. So that's what we try to focus on, that evergreen stuff. Do you know what I mean?
I do. And that's having that ability to adapt to what's coming and what's, you know, and you can't see it, you don't know it, but I feel like if you're only taught how to read out of a textbook and figure things out, you don't have that ability to change on the fly. You know, you're stuck in that one system. But I don't know. So you've got a podcast, you've got a book, you've got all sorts of stuff out there. What Where can we go to find you? What do you got out there? What's all that?
So my podcast is called The Expat Money Show. We've done over 100 episodes now. We've had people like Grant Cardone, Jim Rogers, Doug Casey, lots of really cool, smart people on the show. Usually people who are building their businesses or investing overseas. It's a fun show. It's very conversational. I enjoy doing it. That's at expatmoneyshow.com, or you can go on any of your favorite podcasting apps, Stitcher Radio, Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, things like that. Otherwise, check out my work, my writing at escapeartist.com. It is the largest and oldest offshore website in the world. It's from a very libertarian perspective, libertarian with a small L, not large L. I don't know anything about the party. I don't know anything about politics. But once again, it's those things of personal responsibility, anti-war, you know, anti-government interaction or intervention into our lives. And we teach you all those types of things. I have a book, a magazine, newsletters. I mean, just look up my name, Mikkel Thorup. You'll probably find lots of stuff out there. Lots and lots and lots of stuff. I'm kind of hyper.
Indeed, there are many things out there. And I will throw some of those links in the show notes for folks. I'd encourage them to go check that all out. I am to close it out, you guys. I gave you all the rundown at the top of the show, so I won't do it now, other than to remind you that all the links to Mikkel's stuff will be in the show notes, books, podcasts, website, etc. He's definitely a guy worth looking into, checking out. Very knowledgeable, very helpful, and a good dude. Good dude to boot. So go check it out, and carry on your day. Enjoy yourselves. Be calm. Be peaceful. Get out there. Sow those seeds of liberty. We can all reap sheaves of freedom together. I'm gonna ride us's dream. I'm gonna ride us's dream. I'm gonna ride us's dream.